good evening, everyone, and thank you, Dr. Serif, for your kind invitation and for congratulations for amazing first international online congress. I'm very happy to be one of 20 international speakers. So this evening, I'm gonna share with all of you about my lecture, about my topic, new minimal invasive approach, new technique in the extreme atrophic jaws rehabilitation. As you will see later during my lecture, using a reduced number of implants, using a treated implants, as you will see later. Before we start, I'd like to introduce myself. I am an oral surgeon from Italy. I come from a small town in the south of Italy, Isernia, where I work in my clinic with my father and with my brother. As you can see from those pictures about my clinics, where I have a dedicated room for oral surgery, implantology, and implant prosthetic rehabilitation. And I have one fifth floor dedicated, as you can see on the right side of the picture, only for pediatric dentistry and orthodontics treatment, because I think it's very important in our profession to have a multidisciplinary approach. It's very, very important. But also I spend some of my time in Milan as a adjunct professor at San Raffaele University and as oral surgeon in San Raffaele Hospital in Milan. And as you can see, this is my teamwork. And on the left, I was with the ideator of the All-on-4 concept, Professor Paul Malot, most famous in the world, to introduce a new approach to treat atrophic jaws rehabilitation, like All-on-4 concept. And I'm glad to be one of the members of the International Extraction Academy of California, as you can see. So now we can start. As you can see from this graph, in the latest year, the number of the dentous people is increased. In fact, in the next future years, there will be about 30 million of the dentous people in one or in both arches. So it's very important to know and to have a different technique to treat this particular patient with extreme and bone resorption, as you will see later. Also in the particular patient with the particular general state of health, with the systemic disease, it's very important to reduce the invasivity, to reduce the morbidity, obtaining the same outcomes, the same result, the same aesthetic and the functional result. It's very, very important, as you will see later. So it's very important to know what's happened after teeth extraction. In fact, after I removed one dental element, as you can see, in the six months, we have a bone loss about 23%, especially in the vestibular side. In the next 2 years, we have another 11% of bone loss. And after the 3 years later, we have a loss of bone about 40%, as you can see from this study. So it's very important to know the technique to preserve the bone and to treat this patient with the severe bone resorption. And this is the most famous classification about the bone resorption, the classification COVID AOL. As you can see, we have on the left 6 classes in the mandible and 5 classes in the maxilla. The same bone resorption, but with a different direction and different speed, as you will see later. So we have one class, ideal situation, ideal clinical situation, when we have a full bone around dental element, a good blood supply, until to the last class, when and where we haven't a sufficient bone, extreme bone resorption. So in this class, it's not possible to treat this patient without bone regeneration or without alternative technique, as we will see later. The same classification and the same bone resorption also in the maxilla, from the fifth class to the last class. So this is the normal situation during the good healing of the residual dental elements. So when we have a good healing of the soft tissue and the bone, we have a good blood supply. But after the extraction, we haven't a good blood supply. So it's possible to have a bone resorption with different speed and with different direction. And it's very important in this type of surgery, but I think it's very important in all our type of oral surgery approach, to have a good knowledge about the anatomical surgery. As you can see on the left, this is the cadaver dissection, to show the vascularization and the innervation of the mandible and the upper jaw is very, very important. As you can see on the right, the vascularization, the emergence of the nasopalatine nerve, the emergence of the palatine artery in the posterior side of the maxilla, the shape of the residual alveolar crest is very, very important, the knowledge of the anatomical structure. And have a look at this simple case. After the extraction of one dental element in aesthetic zone, so we have a reduction of the thickness, reduction of height of a bone, as you can see, a change of shape of soft tissue. And it's very important to know that aspect, because we have not only the change of the bone, but also a change of the shape of the soft tissue. And it's very important also for a long-term survival of our implant to preserve and to manage the soft tissue and the keratinized tissue. The quality and the thickness of the keratinized tissue around our implants, especially in those type of rehabilitation, because it's very important to preserve and to avoid the mucositis and the perimplantitis. And it's possible having a good management, a good thickness, as you will see later, of soft tissue around our implants. Another cadaver dissection, as you can see on the left, after teeth extraction, frequently we haven't a sufficient height, a sufficient thickness of the bone in the posterior area, but frequently we have a sufficient height thickness in the anterior side. So following the new concept, the new treatment, it's possible to place the implant in the anterior side, avoiding the posterior side of the mandible or the maxilla, avoiding the mandible, the emergence of the mental nerve, and using a very long implant to reduce the cantilever. This is very important. And on the right, as you can see, we have, in case of the extreme atrophy, an alteration of the normal anatomy, because as you can see on the right, we have a superficial emergence over of the mental nerve, and it's very important to know that during the flaps design approach, because it's very important to avoid during the incision of the flap to avoid the emergence of the mental nerve. So it's very important always, as you will show later, to check always the emergence of the mental nerve to avoid the injury of the mental nerve. Always I will check the emergence of the mental nerve. I think it's our goal in this approach. So we have many studies, many publications about the bone resorption. For example, after the extraction of a single molars and the premolars, after 1 year, we have a loss, bone loss about 50%. And the average diameter of the bone before the extraction is 12 millimeters. After 1 year, it will be 5.9 millimeters, a very extreme bone resorption. Another publication to show the change of the bone shape, as you can see from the left side to the right side, in 120 mandible or cadaver with extraction for 3 months, as you can see. And the bone resorption is the most important when we have more extraction, as you can see. So it's very important the management of the extraction, and when it's possible, our goal is to preserve the residual dental element. But if it's not possible to preserve the dental element, it's necessary to know the technique to avoid the bone resorption or to treat the bone atrophy. As you can see, for example, in extreme case of the bone resorption in the mandible, we have a reduction of the thickness and a reduction of height of alveolar crest and an increment of intermaxillary relationship. And this is another aspect most important,
because in case of the rehabilitation of extreme atrophy, it's very important to use in the final prosthetic rehabilitation the fake gingiva to increase, to improve, to obtain a good vertical dimension and a good vertical relationship. It's very, very important, as you will see later with the prosthetic approach. So we have, in the mandible, we will have a third skeletal class, as you can see, because we have a particular type of bone direction resorption in the mandible, a reduction of the soft tissue and a reduction of a quality of the bone, especially in the posterior side of the mandible, where the quality of the bone is lower. So in the maxilla and in the mandible, we have two different directions of the bone resorption. In the maxilla, where the quality the bone is lower respect to the mandible, we have a centripetal resorption. And in the posterior side of the maxilla, we have a after teeth extraction and hyperclimatization of the maxillary sinus, and the quality of the bone is lower. So using this approach, it's possible to use only the anterior bone with high quality to obtain high primary stability, because in 99% of my cases, I do always immediate loading, because I think also in case of extreme atrophy, the immediate loading is the best way to improve the osseous integration, as we will see later. So in the maxilla, we have a centripetal resorption, and we have an increment of intermaxillary distance and hyperclimatization of the maxillary sinus. Instead, in the mandible, we have another type of direction of the bone resorption, centrifugal resorption. We will have a third skeletal class with the reduction of the thickness and the height of the bone in the posterior side. Frequently, we have a sufficient bone in the height and in the thickness in the anterior side, frequently. So using this approach, it's possible to avoid in the posterior side where frequently the quality of a bone is lower. Have a look at this simple clinical case. After the extraction of a second upper molar, as you can see, after 3 years later, we have a bone resorption with the vertical and horizontal direction with the different time and different speed, as you can see. So in this case, on the right, as you can see on the right X-ray, it's not possible to place the implant without bone regeneration like crestal sinus lift or like maxillary sinus lift, because the maxillary sinus lift is a good therapy, is a predictable therapy, absolutely, as you can see from this study, for example. As you can see from the CT scan, it's possible to see that the patient hasn't a height of a bone in the posterior side of the maxilla. So in this case, I do maxillary sinus lift. At the same time, I place my implants with a good primary stability, and I fill the cavity with a mixture with autolog and heterolog bone, because in my practice, when it's possible, I prefer to place at the same time the implants, at the same time of the maxillary sinus lift, to obtain a good healing of the bone regenerated and to reduce and to avoid the bone resorption during the healing. As you can see on the right, we have the final restoration, but it's very important to see the TC reconstruction after 4 months later. And as you can see, it's possible to see a good healing of the bone around our implant. So this is a predictable therapy, as you can see in this case. Always the same approach, triangular flap, I do maxi or lateral window, and I place it at the same time to implants, and I fill the cavity with the heterolog and autolog bone. So this is a predictable therapy, but is more invasive, especially for particular type of patient with particular systemic disease. So predictable therapy, good therapy, but more invasive with more biological cost and more morbidity for our patient. Have a look at this old case, for example. In this case, the patient has in the maxilla 12 fixtures, 12 implants, for full maxillary rehabilitation, as you can see. And it's possible at the same time to see a severe perimplantitis, especially in the left side of the maxilla, because we have more implants, more titanium, and less bone and less vascularization. So it's not possible using this approach, more implant and less bone, to obtain a long-term survival of our implants. It's not possible to have a good blood supply of on the bone and on the soft tissue. So it's necessary to introduce a new approach, reducing the number of the implants, obtaining the same outcomes, the same prosthetic, the same aesthetic and the functional result. Is very, very important. This is the opposite approach, the extreme approach, only for implants, for example, for full maxillary rehabilitation. So with this approach, according to the X-ray, according to the general state of the patient, it's possible to place only for implants to increase the bone around the implants. So in this case, we have less implants and more bone, more vascularization around the bone, around the soft tissue. This is a new approach, new minimal invasive approach. So with this approach, it's possible to reduce the timing of our treatment, to reduce the biological and the economical cost, to obtain a standard protocol, as you will see later, and it's very important, to follow always the protocol. According to the age of the patient, the general state of health of the patient, according to the systemic disease, according to the state of the residual dental elements, according to the intermaxillary relationship, is very important, surgical, but it's very important, the prosthetical approach, and the morphology of and the alteration of the residual cresta alveolar bone. In my practice, I never use, as you will see later, surgical guide, but I prefer use a three ends approach, but following always the prosthetic approach, following always the final prosthetic result. It's very important to place the implants in the bone, to manage the soft tissue around the implant, to obtain a good prosthetic result. So it's very important surgical approach, but it's very, very important the prosthetic approach during the implant placement. So this is our goal, to reduce the invasivity, to reduce the biological cost, to reduce the morbidity, to obtain the same result, the same outcomes. It's very important, this approach. So it's possible to have a different clinical situation. If we have a sufficient bone in the maxilla, full bone in the posterior side, I will place straight implants according to the traditional technique. If we have a sufficient bone, it's possible to treat this patient with the maxillary sinus lift, the bone regeneration, or introducing a new approach, new concept, tilted implant to avoid the maxillary sinus, to reduce the cantilever, to use a very long implant to obtain a good primary stability to do medial loading and to increase the surface contact between the implant and the bone. Those concepts are based the base of this approach. It's very, very important. We have another alternative to maxillary sinus, pterygoid implant, tuberosity implant, transinus implant, until to zygoma rehabilitation, but this is not our topic in this evening. And another concept I think is very important, the introduced in the practice, the conscious sedation. I do always this surgery with the conscious sedation to reduce the anxiety of the patient, to increase the complaints, to reduce the bleeding during our surgery, to reduce the blood pressure, to obtain a good surgical view. Is very important, the management of the patient. As you can see on the right, with a short video, two shows the approach during the conscious sedation, to use a particular drug to reduce the anxiety of the patient. As you can see, very easy approach, but it's very important to improve the result of our surgery. And on the left, for example, the clinical situation in particular patient with the particular systemic disease like blood disease, blood coagulation issue. It's very important to know this situation because it's a normal situation in this patient. So it's very important before our surgery to have all information about the general state of our patient. Also, because it's possible to use a particular drugs to reduce the edema, to reduce the swelling, and to reduce the pain. For example, normally, according to the clinical situation of the patient, I use always 4 milligrams of cortisone before the surgery and 4 milligrams immediately after my surgery to reduce the edema and to reduce the swelling. And we have different tools to check the heart activity, to check the blood pressure, but I prefer to use the life monitor. So if we have a substitute bone, as you can see in this easy case, it's possible to place straight implants according to the traditional technique, following always, as you can see on the right, the final prosthetic result, to use the skewed crown for the provisional and the final rehabilitation, because I think in the implant rehabilitation, is necessary to use, should be necessary to use the skewed crown. And it's possible to use the skewed crown only if you follow the correct prosthetic approach during the implant placement, as you can see. And I use always the provisional rehabilitation to obtain a good shape of the soft tissue, as you can see at the final rehabilitation, with a good aesthetic and good function result. But this is easy case. As you can see on the left in the final X-ray, we have a full bone in the posterior side of the maxilla, so it's possible to place straight implants, axial implants, without bone regeneration. Easy case. Another case, for example, as you can see, we have a severe periodontal disease in the maxilla and in the mandible. On the right, the extraoral situation, but in the maxilla, we have a full bone also in the posterior side. So in this case, I removed all the residual dental elements, I placed the 6 axial implant, and I do also in this case in medial loading, as you can see on the right. 6 axial implant without cantilever, with the perfect balance, perfect parallelism between the implants, according to the prosthetic rehabilitation. This is the situation after 6 months later, with amazing aiming of the soft tissue around our implants and below the final prosthetic rehabilitation. Also in this case, I use a little bit of the fake gingiva to obtain a good shape of the final dental elements and to obtain a good intermaxillary relationship. The details about the final Toronto screw and the made in ceramic, a perfect parallelism between our implants and the final X-ray, because we have a full bone, so it's possible to use a easy technique, straight implants without bone regeneration. The same approach in the mandible, for example. If we have a subject bone, it's possible to place 4, for example, also in this case, 4 axial implants, also in the posterior side of the mandible. Checking always the parallelism between our implant during implant site preparation to obtain an easy prosthetic approach during the prosthetic procedure is very important. The prosthetic procedure according to the correct surgical placement of our implant. And it's very important to have a good surgical view, as you can see. It's very important to have a good bone skeletalization to obtain a good surgical view and the perfect implant placement, as you can see in this case. Another case, for example, as you can see on the left, we have on the TC scan reconstruction, we have a reduction of the thickness, but we have a sufficient bone height also in the posterior side. So using a particular approach with the palatal flap, as you can see on the left, below the picture on the left and on the right, it's possible with the palatal flap to place 6 axial implant to preserve the vestibular bone and to increase at the same time the soft tissue around our implants with only one step and only one surgery. And I used always the suture to hold the palatal flap to obtain a good surgical view. Also, in the palatal bone, we have a better blood vascularization for our implant. Following always the prosthetic protocol, as you can see above on the right, six-axial implant with perfect parallelism between our implants. But it's very important, the prosthetic procedure using, for example, six provisional abutment, on the right, the provisional rehabilitation, and below, it's possible to see the clinical situation a few hours later, also in this case, in medial loading, but it's very important to see the clinical situation 6 months later. Amazing result, amazing healing of our tissue around our implant with the palatal flap, only with the palatal flap to increase the keratinized tissue. And as you can see, it's possible to change the shape of the residual crystal because we have an increase of the soft tissue around the implant. And it's very important, this concept, to avoid the mucositis and to avoid the perimplantitis in the next future. So also in this case, with one surgery, with one step, it's possible to place the implant, to do immediate loading, and to increase the soft tissue. And here we go. When we have a suction bone in the posterior side of the maxilla, it's possible to introduce a tilted implant to reduce the invasivity, to obtain the same outcomes and the same result. The concept of tilted implants was introduced by Kekman 20 years ago, and according to this protocol, it's possible to reduce the number of implants in the mandible and the maxilla, using, for example, only 4 or 6 implants, avoiding in the mandible the posterior side of the bone, where the quality is lower, avoiding the emergence of the mental nerve, reducing the cantilever, and to place the implant in the site where the quality of bone is very high. Also, the same approach in the maxilla, 4 or 6 implant with distal tilted implant to avoid the maxillary sinus, avoiding the posterior side of the maxilla where the quality is lower, to use a very long implant to obtain a good primary stability and to increase the surface contact between the implants and the bone. Those are the schematization about the All-on-4, about the reduced number of implants. Using, for example, short implants, it's possible, tilted implants, tuberosity implants, and on the needle, the All-on-4 concept. 2 distal implants, posterior side of the maxilla to avoid the maxillary sinus, 2 axial implant, the anterior side, the same approach in the mandible. This is our protocol and is very important, following always this protocol. For example, this simple case, as you can see on the X-ray on the left, we have a failed implant in the right side of the maxilla. So according to the protocol, it's possible to remove the failed implants with the mucositis and the perimplantitis, and at the same time, I place 2 implants. 1 tilted implant following the anterior wall of the sinus, as we can see from the red, the yellow line, and 1 axial implant in the anterior side. And I do always this kind of immediate loading with the minimal invasive approach. And it's very important to place before the tilted implants and after the axial implant. Because if I place it before the axial implant, after it's not possible to change the direction of the tilted implant. And it's very, very important, according to the atrophy, according to the shape of the sinus. Also in this case, I do immediate restoration, as you can see, I place the multi-unit abutment on the top of the external connection of the implants. I do immediate rehabilitation without occlusal loading, and on the right, the X-ray post-op. 1 tilted implant avoiding the maxillary sinus, 3.8 diameter, and 13 of length, and in the anterior side, 3.8 of diameter, and 11 length. And this is the final situation 4 months later with the final prosthetic rehabilitation, skewed bridge, and the X-ray to show the good osseointegration around our implants. In only one step and in only one surgery, without bone regeneration, it's possible to obtain a good result and to reduce the invasivity for our patient. Have a look at this surgical video, for example, another case about the failed implants with the patient with the severe perimplantitis and mucositis, as you can see on the right side. This is the initial situation, the X-ray pre-op with the mucositis and peritonitis, the intraoral situation before. It's possible to see the wrong placement and the wrong direction of our implant with the severe peritonitis and mucositis. So it's not possible to preserve the implants. I removed the provision, the abutment. This is the occlusal view. As you can see, I use the particular device to remove with the minimal invasive approach the implants, as you can see, to preserve the bone. Because it's very important to preserve the bone. In fact, I will place at the same time new implants, as you will see later. Now I removed the last anterior implant, as you can see, with the wrong direction. Okay, and we haven't a good soft tissue around the implants. So now it's possible the image after the extraction of the residual implants, the occlusal view, and now it's very important the flaps design with the palatal approach, as you can see, and with the one vertical mesial incision to obtain a good surgical view and to increase at the same time the soft tissue around the future implants, as you will see. The situation after implants removed, as you can see, using particular device, it's possible to preserve the bone, to reduce the bone resorption. And now it's possible to place my implants, the occlusal view, following the protocol. I started with the distal implant, as you can see, with the palatal approach, following always the anterior side of the maxillary sinus, as you can see. After the fist bring, I check always the direction and the inclination of the implant, as you can see. Now, if it's okay, it's possible to go on with another drill. And it's very important, the under preparation site, to increase the primary stability to do immediate loading. I used a very long implant after implant site preparation, about 3.75 diameter, following always the anterior side of the sinus, and 16 of lengths to obtain a primary stability around by anchoring on the nasal basal bone, where the quality of the bone is very high, to obtain a good primary stability. So I started with the 30 newton of torque and I increased it until to 50 newton of torque to obtain high primary stability. Now it's possible to prepare the anterior side to change the direction of the fist brown implant. As you can see, I correct the direction and I place the pin to check always the correct direction. Now I check if it's okay, it's possible to go on. I continued with the implant site preparation and I check my implant, 3.75 of diameter and 11.5 of length, with high primary stability more than 50 newton of torque. So it's possible to do immediate loading. I placed my extreme abutment, my unit abutment, and I covered these dehiscence with the resorbable membrane, as you can see with the pin, the occlusal view. Recovered using the bone chips recovered by the osteotomy, the resorbable suture, the increasing of the soft tissue, and as you can see, it's possible to see the very important concept of this protocol, using one axial implant and one very long tilted implant to anchoring by anchoring on the nasal basal bone to obtain high primary stability. Also, because this is a very extreme case, in fact, we haven't a sufficient bone to do a vertical bone augmentation. The provisional rehabilitation, also in this case, I do immediately provisional rehabilitation, provisional rehabilitation without occlusal loading. So at the same time, it's possible to increase also the keratinitis tissue, because our goal is the management, as you can see on the right on this image, the management of soft tissue, also in the mandible, the same approach. And in the mandible, it's possible also in the maxilla, for example, in this approach to use a surgical guide according to the knowledge, according to the skills and the experience by our surgeon. It's possible to put in the medial side the surgical guide and to place distal implants between 30 degrees until to 45 degrees, according to the atrophy of the mandible or the maxilla, according to the bone resorption of the mandible over the maxilla, and two axial implants. This is the correct approach. For example, clinical case, I used in this case the surgical guide, and I placed four axial implants, two distal tilted and two anterior axial implants, following always the parallelism and the correct parallelism between our implants. The surgical procedure from the implant site preparation, on the right, the implant with the multi-unit abutment, and below it's possible to see the healing of the soft tissue 4 months later, because during my surgery I used a correct management, a correct flap to increase the keratinized tissue around our implants, and during the impression it's possible to see a good healing of the soft tissue, a good thickness of the keratinized tissue to avoid the mucositis and the perimplantitis in the next future. And using this approach, it's possible to treat also the extreme case. As you can see, this very extreme bone resorption. As you can see on the left in the X-ray, it's possible to see a very bone resorption in the mandible. The patient hasn't a sufficient height of the bone in the posterior side with the superficial emergence of the mental nerve. We have a little bit of bone in the anterior side. And on the right, the intraoral situation with a reduction of the, a change of the shape of the soft tissue, a change of the shape of the alveolar crestal bone, as you can see. But using this approach, as you can see on the left, it's possible to place four implants, two tilted in the posterior side, the two in the anterior side, and to do immediate loading. And it's very important to see the flaps design that I used, because I used in this case only one medial incision, avoiding to the vertical distal incision, because in this case we have a very extreme bone resorption and we have a superficial emergence of the mental nerve. So I use only one medial incision, avoiding the injury of the mental nerve. And on the right, I do immediate loading. This is the provisional rehabilitation a few hours later. As you can see, we have a sufficient fake gingiva, because it's very important in this case to increase the vertical dimension, because we have an extreme case of the bone resorption. So the fake gingiva is absolutely necessary in this case, in particular this case. The immediate loading a few hours later, and on the right, the X-ray post-op shows four implants, two distal and two axial implants, avoiding the posterior side of the mandible, avoiding the emergence of the mental nerve. And the final situation 5 months later, with osseointegration of the implants, and on the right, the final prosthetic rehabilitation. This is orthopedic rehabilitation, because we have a sufficient fake gingiva to increase the vertical dimension. This is very important, this aspect. And using this protocol, it's possible, for example, to treat at the same time both arches. As you can see from this extreme case, on the left we have the initial X-ray. The patient has a severe periodontal disease with the reduction of the vertical dimension, so I removed all residual dental elements, and at the same time I placed four implants in the maxilla and four implants in the mandible, following all of four concepts, and I do at the same time medial loading. As you can see on the right, those are the final provisional rehabilitation. One surgery, one step for both arches at the same time with the minimal invasive approach, following always the protocol, because it's very important. Have a look at this case. This is a wrong approach. a crazy approach. In fact, in this case, the colleague removed it. He removed all dental residual elements and replaced the casual implant. Casual placed the, 4 implants in the mandible and 6 implants in the maxilla, with the casual and the wrong approach. So it's not possible to treat with the prosthetic approach this patient because this is a wrong approach. Another wrong approach, for example, the colleague placed the 4 short implants in the mandible. But as you can see, we have a subject bone also in the posterior side. So it's not necessary to place 4 implants and also 4 short implants. And on the right, the crazy prosthetic rehabilitation. So it's necessary to follow the correct protocol, and this is instead the correct protocol in the mandible. 2 axial implants and the 2 distal tilted implants in the posterior side. And as you can see on the left, I check always the emergence of the mental nerve, and I use the pencil to mark the emergence of the mental nerve on the bone, because it's very important to place the distal implant on the top of the emergence of the mental nerve to reduce the cantilever. This is our goal, because if I place the distal implant in the anterior side, it's not possible to reduce the cantilever. So using a tilted implant and using a correct emergence of the distal implant on the top of the emergence of the mental nerve, it's possible to avoid the posterior side of the mandible, avoiding the emergence of the mental nerve, and to reduce the cantilever. On the right, the implant, the prosthetic rehabilitation, and below the situation a few hours later, also in this case, immediate loading, the best way to increase dose integration. Using the multi-unit abutment, for example, in this case, 30 degrees in the posterior side and 0 degree in the anterior side, according to the correct emergence of the implant. And it's very important to know the biomechanism about the tilted implants and the axial implant. In fact, the axial implant can work alone and can support the axial force, but don't support the lateral force. Instead, the tilted implant can't work alone because don't support the axial force, but the tilted implant can work only if linked with other implants. It's very important to know this difference for the biomechanical approach. And this is the correct approach in the mandible. I always check the emergence, as you can see, of the mental nerve, because it's very important to avoid the injury of the mental nerve, to obtain a good surgical view, and to place the distal implant on the top of the emergence of the mental nerve. This is the right protocol. And another concept very important in this approach is the ostectomy, is to do a correct ostectomy, because it's necessary to place the implant at the same level. Is very, very important. As you can see, this is not alone for concept in this case, but it's very important to see the correct use of the ostectomy. On the left, the initial situation, but it's not possible to place the implants in this situation. I need to do a good ostectomy to place the implants at the same time. As you can see in this image, after the ostectomy, now I obtain a good shape of the bone, and it's possible to place the implant at the same time. So the ostectomy is another concept very important in this approach. And this is the occlusal view after implant placement. Now my implants are at the same level of the bone. And also in this case, as you can see, I use a particular flap design. I use only 1 medial incision to avoid the superficial emergence of the mental nerve in the posterior side of the mandible, obtaining a good surgical view. Because it's very important during the implant placement to follow always the final prosthetic project. It's very important to obtain a good aesthetic result. As you can see, different situation with the good aesthetic result in simple case until to the extreme atrophy of a bone resorption of extreme case of the atrophy in the mandible and the maxilla. Because don't forget this concept, implant dentistry is a prosthetic discipline with the surgical component. So it's very important following always the protocol. And using this approach, it's possible to reduce the number of implants, 4 or 6, for full maxillary or mandibular rehabilitation, avoiding the posterior site of the mandible and the maxilla, using a tilted implant before until to 30 degree, until to 45 degree, using a standard protocol, an easy protocol, to obtain an immediate loading, avoiding the bone graft, to reduce the invasivity, to obtain the same result and the same outcomes. And this is the resume about the using of the tilted implants, 4 in the mandible and 4 in the maxilla, avoiding the posterior site. And we have many publications to show the correct use and the good use of the minimal invasive approach in the treatment of the atrophic jaws. And actually, it's possible to have a many study about the atrophic jaw rehabilitation using tilted implant. And actually, the using of tilted implants is a good therapy, a minimal invasive therapy, and a predictable therapy. The same approach in the maxilla, for example, is very important when we have atrophy to have a good palatal approach to preserve the vestibular bone and to increase the bulk vascularization around our implants. As you can see in this case, I used the palatal flap, I used always the suture to hold the flap, good surgical view, and I prepare my implant site with the palatal approach. Because in this approach, it's very important to use the anterior site of the maxilla where we have a good quality of the bone to obtain a good primary stability, avoiding to the posterior site of the maxilla. According to the protocol, after implant site preparation, it's possible to place, as you can see on the left, my implant with the palatal approach, and on the right, after implant site preparation, with the palatal approach. Only one step, only one surgery to place my implant, to do immediate loading, to increase the soft tissue around our implant. This is correct protocol. And have a look, another surgical case about the maxillary rehabilitation in a patient with a residual dental elements in the maxilla. As you can see, Okay, initial situation, I removed the residual dental elements because it's not possible to preserve. And after I removed the residual dental element, it's possible to do this protocol. I started with the good flaps design. I used a trapezoidal flap with the palatal approach and 2 vertical distal incisions, as you can see. This is palatal approach, and I do 2 vertical distal incisions to obtain a good surgical view, because in case of extreme atrophy, it's very important to have a good surgical view to see a good shape of the maxillary sinus. I use it always free hands surgery. Trapezoidal flap, I reflect the flap, as you can see, and I remove the inflammatory tissue. And this is the residual bone after the extraction, and the surgical view, palatal flap. It's possible to see a good view of the palatal bone site, as you can see. This is a good view. And after the osteotomy, it's very important to do the osteotomy. In this case, I use a straightened piece with the traditional drills to obtain a good shape of the bone. And in other cases, it's possible to use the bone clamps to obtain the bone chips, and I use the residual bone chips to fill the residual cavity after implant placement. And I started with the distal, with the posterior tilted implant. As you can see, palatal approach, following always the anterior wall of the sinus. I used the first and the second drill, and after I will check the correct direction of my implant. As you can see, I prepare with the second drill the implant site. I check the correct direction, as you can see. I continue to prepare the implant site with the under prepare the site to obtain a good primary stability, as you can see, following away the anterior site, by anchoring on the nasal basal bone, and I place my implant 3.75 of diameter and 16 of length to obtain a good primary stability to do an immediate loading. As you can see, I started with 30 Newton torque and I continued with 50 Newton to obtain a high primary stability, as you can see. So now it's possible, this is the X-ray after implant placement. The same approach in the left side, first drill and second drill, following always the anterior wall of the sinus. I check the direction of the distal implant using the pin. If it's okay, it's possible to go on using the same implant in the same dimension, 16 of length, to obtain high primary stability. 30 Newton increase until to 50 Newton. High primary stability. Now it's possible to prepare the anterior side with the palatal approach to preserve the bundle bone and the vestibular side, as you can see. And during preparation, I check always the parallelism between the implants, especially in the anterior side. And if it's okay, it's possible to continue to place the implant. As you can see, I check the parallelism between the implants, as you can see. Now it's possible to continue with the implant placement with high primary stability, more than 50 Newton. I used 40.2 diameter and 13 of length. I placed the multi-unit abutment, as you can see, with the occlusal view, the frontal view. I do the suture. I use always the reabsorbable suture with the correct management of the soft tissue around the implants. The situation after a few hours, and the X-ray post-op, two distally, avoiding the maxillary sinus, this is the anterior wall of the maxillary sinus, and two straight implants with the medial loading, as you can see, four provisional abutments, the implant, the provisional rehabilitation before the immediate loading, the situation a few hours later. So the initial situation and the situation 6 hours later, in only one surgery with the minimally invasive approach, and the healing 1 week later. Now I will show the last case, full case phases about the maxillary rehabilitation. As you can see, this is the intraoral situation. Also in this case, the patient has a severe periodontal disease in the maxilla and in the mandible. Intraoral situation, right side and the left side with the reduction of the vertical dimension. The extraoral situation is very important to have always the extraoral photos to choose a good shape of the final dental elements. The X-ray pre-op, as you can see, we have a severe periodontal disease in the maxilla and in the mandible. We haven't a sufficient height of the bone in the posterior side. We have a bone only in the anterior side of the maxilla. The CBCT reconstruction to show the chronic sinusitis in the right, in the left sinus, and a little bit in the right sinus, but we have a sufficient thickness of the bone, as you can see. So it's possible to use this protocol. And this is a short video to show the surgical procedure, but I will show better each surgical phases before the end of my lecture. The initial situation, as you can see. The occlusal view. The intraoral situation. I do the surgical flap, the same flap, trapezoidal flap, two distal incision to obtain a good surgical view, as you can see. After the osteotomy, I placed the before the posterior implants and after the axial implant to obtain also in this case high primary stability. Also in this case, I use a very long implants to increase the primary stability. I check the
the parallelism in the anterior site, the situation after implant site preparation and implant site implant placement. I used the multi-unit abutment according to the protocol, the resorbable suture, and the final provisional rehabilitation a few hours later in the medial static and in median function. And this is the X-ray post-op. So now I will show better each surgical phase's procedure. On the left, the situation after the extraction of the ventral element. It's very important to have a good surgical view, as you can see on the right, using a correct flaps design, trapezoidal flap, do occlusal view, the use of the suture to hold the flap to have a good...
Dear Angelo, my friend, last 5 minutes, please.
Okay. I just finished. I almost finished. The occlusal view. So it's possible after the aesthetic following with the anterior wall of the maxillary sinus, I start I check always the reaction of the procedure according to the protocol and check always the correct reaction as it's okay, it's possible to go on in our view as we can see. And after the consult preparation, it's possible to implants about 4.0 kilometers of length. One implant between a full final of the energy. This is the to see a good part of patient that is the receiver and the final situation of 2 hours later, it is the X-ray post-op, it is the 2 hours of the maxillary sinus, the resume of my surgery, for the surgery actually to the medical body, but very important to see the meeting after 4 months later, with a full meeting of the soft tissue. So 2 months later, it's possible to see the final question with the intraoral scanner.
Sorry, Angelo, your sound is a little bit.
Okay. Minutes. The final aesthetic result.
Okay, this is better.
And the right side and the left side, frontal view and occlusal view, as you can see, the extraoral view after my situation, before and after, as you can see, with a good aesthetic and functional result, as you can see. Okay. And I used a particular test, the electromyography test, to check the muscle force between the right and the left side and the final X-ray. So using this approach, it's possible to have a good minimal invasive approach to reduce the invasivity and to reduce the morbidity for our patient. And 1 second to present my new book about the surgical treatment of impacted teeth. It is available now in Italy, but it will be available also in English in the next month. Minimal invasive approach to the treatment of the extraction of the impacted teeth. So thank you very much for your kind attention.
Presentations. Thank you for the great presentation in this minimal invasive approach to reconstruct full arch. So we have many, many questions, and I will send you the first one. So Navid Hussein is asking, can you do zygomatic implants with sedation, or does it have to be under general anesthesia?
In my practice, all my surgery has been done in not in general anesthesia, but in conscious sedation in the my operating room with the colleague to inject the drugs in the vessel. Only conscious sedation, not general anesthesia.
Conscious sedation. Okay. Thank you very much, Navitrusin, for the question and for the answer, Angelo. The next question is from Jeev Jarai. How do you determine the vertical dimension in endolus cases?
Yes, it's very important to make the, before the surgical treatment, to make the correct provisional protocol with the impression, with the master models, and to check using always, it's possible to use always the digital smile design to change the shape of the dental elements, and using the impression, the master models, to check the correct dimension before the surgical treatment, because after my surgery, I have already the provisional rehabilitation made before.
Thank you.
And next provisional rehabilitation next. Also for the final rehabilitation to check the vertical dimension.
Okay. So, question, yes, from again Deep Jarai, your opinion on intraoral welding in case you don't achieve adequate torque.
I haven't experienced about the intraoral welding, because I used the all on four, the original all on four concept. So during the immediate loading, I don't use the framework, I don't use the bar, but only I use the provisional abutment with the provisional rehabilitation. I never use the bar and the framework in the provisional immediate loading. I haven't experienced with the, this approach.
Can you bring the microphone in the near on the mouth, if okay. possible?
Okay.
Or you're in the near of the laptop or with the microphone?
Okay.
I have problems sometimes with the sound.
Can you hear?
Yes, it's okay. So, thank you for the question. Navid Hussein is asking, what is your protocol and plan ensure the implants don't touch each other when one tilted is very close at apex to adjacent to straight implant, 8 millimeter apart, and use of only certain lengths?
Is very important. It's a good reason. Very important to place always before the tilted implant, because if I place it before the anterior, it's not possible to change the implants. To avoid the contact, it's necessary to place the implant in different size, because we have the implant with the
microphone, please. The microphone.
Can you hear me now?
Better with, yeah, come to near to the laptop or with the microphone.
No, I haven't the microphone, I direct on the
piece. Yes, this is good. Yeah, no, it's good, Angelo.
Okay. So it's very important to place the implant according to the protocol. But frequently, if you have a very angulated tilted implant, it's possible to reduce the small axial implant. Not longer, but small. It's very important to use long implants in the distal side.
Thank you, Angelo. When, next question, Navid Hussein. When doing osteoectomy alveoloplasty, do you ever accidentally expose sinus membrane? If so, do you lift it and membrane?
During the osteotomy, according to the bone resorption, I avoid to expose the membrane, the sinus membrane during the osteotomy, because I do the osteotomy especially in the anterior side, only if necessary. Because if you have also the same level of the bone, it's not necessary to do osteotomy. So the osteotomy only if we have a residual crest to do a good plane of the bone.
Thank you. So from the social media, Angelo, many questions to you. Virender Bhava is asking, isn't there any way to determine the base of sinus before drilling?
Yes. According to, depends from the experience, from the knowledge, but it's very important always to have not only the X-ray OPT, but always to see the CBCT reconstruction and to have a good view. And it's very important to do a good flap, because especially in extreme hypertrophy, it's possible to see the blue line, and the blue line is the limit of the maxillary sinus.
Angelo, I know that the anatomical point is to different between alveolar crest and sinus is the color. Yeah. White color is the sinus, red color is, you are saying, alveolar crest. Is this right?
Yeah, yeah.
Is it enough for the anatomical direction, Angel?
According to the knowledge, the experience, the sensibility of the oral surgeon. It's possible in the cases using also the surgical guide, but I never use, I prefer to use hands-free.
Hands-free. Very nice. Thank you for the answer. Thank you for the great question. The next one. So, okay. Nitin Moral is asking how you get the nerve to know what is the exact position of sinus lining. This is, not, I think, the same. And how much tilting do you do? How to confirm that our drill is away?
About the tilting, the maximum tilting is 45 degrees. But depending from the bone resorption, because if I have an extreme bone resorption, it's necessary to tilt until 45 degrees, according to the shape of the residual bone. But the range is 30 until to 45 degrees. And using multi-unit abutment with the 30 degrees, it's possible to obtain a correct emergence of the implants.
Again, the same question in the same direction. Ahmed Nurain is asking, how will you determine the correction position of the maxillary sinus after flap reflection? Okay.
Yeah, it's the same.
Same question. Okay, also the same. Okay, Tarek Saleh is asking, what is type of implants did you use? Basal, strategical, hybrid, or conventional types?
I use different type of implants, but is very important the shape of the implants to do immediate loading and to choose a correct implants with the correct prosthetic tools. In the Toronto Skewed, I prefer to use external connection, but actually I start to use also the conical connection to increase the bone around also the multi-unit abutments. So it's very important to choose the implants that has a correct tools for the prosthetic rehabilitation and a correct shape of the implants for the under prepare of the site to increase the media loading. It's very important.
I think Angelo Navid Hussein is your fan. He sent, I think, 10 questions here. Cool. And I continue with the next question. So, Navid Hussein, this is your part. Can you do, this was already finished, which restorative material and design do you prefer long-term? Metallic ceramic, zirconia, or acrylic resin?
I prefer composite material for the final restoration, for the flange, for the fake gingiva, but it's possible to use also the zirconia for the dental element. Depends for the opposite arch. If I have two full mouth rehabilitation of implants, I don't use the zirconia because it's very hard.
Okay, thank you, Angelo. The next question from your fan. What? When able to, do you ever segment your restoration for full mouth cases? For example, two implants retaining three unit bridge, multiplication three to restore full upper arch.
Sorry, can you repeat? I don't understand.
Okay, when able to, do you ever segment your restoration for full mouth cases? For example, two implants retaining three unit bridge, multiplication three to restore full upper arch.
How many implants?
Two implants retain three unit bridge.
In my case, as you can see from my cases, I prefer use always in extreme atrophy used four implants, because mm-hmm. I think the minimum for to obtain a long-term survival is four implants, especially in the maxilla. I never use two implants in the maxilla.
What is with six implants in the maxilla? What is the
implants? It's possible if I have a posterior sinus, so I place two distal implants, two tilted implants, and four straight implants in the anterior side, if I have a sufficient bone. But frequently, I treat extreme atrophy, so I haven't sufficient bone, and I use four implants. Maxilla, the better is to use six implants for the quality, according to the quality of the bone.
Okay.
In the mandible, four is okay.